Bible, a gathering together of believers.
What no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, what's never entered into the heart of man, that becomes normal for me. The same way trouble used to track you down without you trying, the almighty blessing of God will track you down. Surely goodness and mercy will follow you every day of your life. Get ready for a week like no other week. What no eye has seen, what no ear has heard.
A burden for the lost and a hunger for the word.
The only hope for America is men and women full of the fire, full of the anointing of God. There's no other hope. Without preachers, without men and women whose mouth has been set on fire, that would go and proclaim the gospel every day of the week and shout it from the mountaintops. I believe sitting in this room tonight are men and women that are going to wreck what the enemy's doing. The devil's not going to have America. He's not going to have this land. He's not going to have this land.
The fulfillment of prophecy.
Nobody knew Pastor Shuttlesworth before. He was a little one, but that prophecy was upon his head. A little one shall become a thousand. It's happening practically. And a small one shall become a strong nation. My God. Wata malosa abandola manda. A small one shall become a nation. Do you receive this grace upon your life? A little one shall become a thousand. Receive 1,000 members, 1,000 members, 1,000 members. A little one shall become 1,000.
An outpouring of generosity towards God.
I pray thee, if I have found favor in thine eyes, tarry. For I have learned by experience that the Lord had blessed me for thy sake. Anointing increase. By association there. I'm blessed because of you. See, it's called increase by association. You have that on you as a Christian. His nature, God, is to bless. His prerogative is to bless. His glory is to bless. His delight is to bless. His blessing is without ceasing. Well, Lord, Jesus, touch him. Jesus, touch these people, Lord. Bless them, Lord, and honor them today. Come on, people, keep praying with me. He said, tell him he can live as long as he want to live. Yeah. He can do whatever he want to do in Jesus' mighty name.
The manifest presence of God with signs and wonders.
God says, I want to show off. I want to show the world and the devil my products. I want to show the world what I can do, who I can produce. I want to show off with the church. I want to show off with that woman. I want to show off. I want to show off. It's an exhibition. It's an advertisement. It's a superior, supernatural marketing. I want to show somebody off. God is about to show off with the church. It's about to show off with the gospel. It's about to show off. It's about to showcase.
The gifts of the Holy Spirit at work.
I don't know if the doctor told you, you had a rupture in your eye. Isn't that right? Said it would never be better. Thou foul spirit of blindness, come.
Help!
In Jesus' name, open. You just get a little weary in that limb. Isn't that right? You have the beginning of sugar diabetes in your body. I take it out, the spirit of infirmity. Because you know what's on the other side of your prayer. You know what's on the other side of your miracle. Oh, hallelujah. I got to shout, when no one else is shouting. I got a song when no one else is singing. That's what God wants us to do. Thank God for the Spirit of Almighty God.
I am born of God. I am in Christ. I go from victory to victory. I go from glory to glory. And I go from strength to strength. I don't go from sickness to sickness. Oh, how does it feel to fail? How does it feel to lose? And I said, you know what? Why don't I ask the biggest loser that ever lived? So I said, where can I find the biggest loser? And I remember what the word of the Lord said. For the biggest loser was under my feet. I said, hey, loser, how does it feel to lose? And just as he was about to speak, I put my foot down. And I said, hey, you lost the opportunity to speak again. You are not allowed to speak. Somebody shout hallelujah.
A surge of people being called into the full-time ministry.
Because the Bible says, go into all the earth, into all the world, and preach the gospel to everyone, everywhere. So I've got a part to play. I need to work. If you want to take over the land, you have a role to play.
May the Abrahamic grace to command your household to keep the way of the Lord come upon you today. That God won't be something on your list of things to do. You will be a God first, church first, Bible first, first century Book of Acts Christian, and your children and your children's children. Receive that today. I see America turning around by the hand of God.
These are the trademarks of revival.
California, that's Marina Del Rey. I shot that video myself. I'm Jonathan Shuttlesworth. This is the auditorium where we're having our Los Angeles Crusade. We're here on Friday night, Saturday morning, and Saturday night. January, and it went well, in my opinion. I wanted to come back. Last night was a great start. Yesterday, like I've been posting a lot, is like a dream come true in the ministry because it's what I always wanted to do. We preached in Pittsburgh at our home church there, jumped on a plane, and hit Los Angeles for the night service. And I'm going to give you a peek into that. And I hope you're having a good day wherever you're at. Today's live from Los Angeles. Breaking news, Israel, Iran, America. I was going to break the whole thing down from Bible prophecy, but I don't feel like it. It's sunny out. I'm staying on the ocean. I just don't really feel like getting into Armageddon talk. I'm in a good mood. And so what we are going to do, we'll talk about a little bit. And then I don't get into this stuff, but there was an altercation between Pastor Mark Driscoll and Pastor John Lindell live on stage, and people keep sending it to me and want to know my thoughts. So normally I don't get into that, but we'll take a look, spend a little time together. I won't waste your day. We'll have a good time. Good to see you, Tim, Austin, Bella, Marissa, Heather. Great seeing you in Lancaster, Veronica on the app, Winnie. Everybody that's here, hope I get to see you in Los Angeles tonight. Here's what we did yesterday. Enjoy the footage.
3 minutes.
Oh, of the reel?
The dollar, yeah.
Okay. Let's go. They're not ready with that yet, so let's go to the tweets. Okay. This is J.D. Sharp, a little bit of an extremist position, but I've heard this from a few people. Here's what will happen if we get involved in the conflict between Iran and Israel. You may play it.
Iran just attacked Israel. Here's what's going to happen if the United States gets involved in this conflict. Our border has been wide open for 3 years. At least 8 million people have walked across our border in the last 3 years. Thousands of them are jihadists, actual terrorists that have formed cells here in the United States of America. And they are just waiting for us to get involved in a conflict on behalf of Israel, with Iran, with Jordan, with anyone that decides to back them. Once they do, we're gonna deal with a mass casualty terrorist attack on U.S. soil. And that attack will be used to cancel the 2024 presidential election, to enlist probably 500,000 illegals into our military, many of which will have allegiance to different countries, and obviously start World War.
You guys can keep my mic on. I'm playing this. This sounds extremist. The thing that's of interest to me is my Uncle Ted told me, who's pretty on the money, that he felt like we weren't going to be able to have elections this year. He never prophesied from the pulpit or anything. He just said he felt like there was going to be an attempt to make it where we can't have elections. So this is of note, and it's happening. Actually, I had somebody that's high up in the corporate world. One of the reasons they should have never shut down the country for COVID, among others, is corporations have their own intelligence. So if something's going to come and wipe out the workforce, they would shut down on their own. You know, if you own Subway sandwiches, you have connections with the CIA and FBI and foreign intelligence because it's of your company, in your company's best interest to know what's coming down the pike. So somebody I know that's very high up in the corporate world told me before Iran attacked Israel that they were planning mass pro-Palestinian demonstrations in the cities in the United States, which we're going to get to and show you that. If you've had the border wide open and you have known, just the ones they know about, you're at 200 plus known Middle Eastern terrorists that are in the country. If America backs Israel, you know, Chicago, San Francisco, New York, among other cities, where the government isn't even on America's side. They're on the anti-American side. You're going to have major problems different than you would have had in the past. So that's why I would not just throw away what this guy's saying. And I had been thinking along this route anyway. So go ahead, we'll continue it.
Or three. That is what happens.
Pause
if
it real quick
we
again.
Get involved.
You know, if you're going to go online and do a video, make sure to throw on your best undershirt. It's a good look with the youth pastor gelled hair from 2007 and the Luke from 902 Beverly Hills 90210 sideburns. Continue.
Between Israel and Iran. And it sounds like Biden wants to. And obviously we'll have a draft as well. Gen Z, you're going to get what you asked for. You're going to be fighting overseas. Our veterans will be declared active duty, the ones that are
attacked. I am a part of the church.
Iran just attacked Israel. Here's what's going to happen if the United States gets involved in this conflict.
Back to me.
Our border has been wide open for 3 years.
Okay, so that's what you're dealing with. We'll get into that more. Here's what we did yesterday, Sunday, as a ministry. Go ahead and roll it.
I am a part of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, I will, not I'll try, I will build my church. I'm going to build it, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. When someone asks me a question about my faith, it's not illegal for me to say something about it. And I want to tell you that, since we're in America, they make you sound like you're fine to believe what you want. But don't share your faith. Don't speak about God in the public square. Meanwhile, everybody's allowed to say whatever crazy belief they have without any retribution. Do you know why that is? Because faith has two parts to it. If you believe in your heart and speak with your mouth, until faith moves your mouth, it never moves any mountain. So the devil actually doesn't care if you believe in God as long as you'll shut up about it. But I'm telling you, the same fire is going to come in California this week, and we're going to send out old school, fire charged, radical Christians that tell the world Jesus saves.
Pause it. Put that last shot back up if you would.
I am a part of the Christians.
Right at the end.
Jesus saves.
Pause. That lady, if you've ever heard me tell the story of the family that kept asking when I was going to come to Los Angeles, and finally the Lord said to just go out and preach to them. That was the first time I ever went to California. That's her. And she's back. And their kids that I prayed for that were like Camila's age are now 21 and 17 or something. She was back with more family. I thought, seeing her at the altar, it's like everything came full circle. Like a Seinfeld episode. Next. All right. My tax dollars, somehow also my tax dollars. Great meme. Next. Remember when they said Trump would get us into a full-blown war with Iran? Times like these should make us all realize how lucky we are to have Trump, his strength, and his resolve. That's Donald Trump Jr., not at all biased. Next. Are these coming on their TV, like all jacked up like this, or just mine? Like all stretched out. How does it look on YouTube? Don't you have it right there? All right, no problem. Sorry, folks, it's a live broadcast from a new studio, so please don't be judgy. Iran has spent decades murdering Israelis. These are things you need to understand when this makes it sound like there's like both sides of the argument. Iran has spent decades murdering Israelis and Jews by proxy. Without Iran, there's no October 7th. Without Iran, there's no Hezbollah. Without Iran, there are no Houthi rockets. Houthi. Iran is not retaliating. If people ask me how I'm doing today, I'm going to say, I'm feeling Houthi. Iran is not retaliating. Iran is attacking Israel as part of its genocidal aim to wipe Israel out. So that's important to note. That where do those Palestinians, I mean, there's not even grocery stores in the Gaza Strip. Where are they getting shoulder fire rockets? Somebody's sponsoring them, and that somebody's Iran that's been fighting proxy wars against Israel for a long time. They want Jewish people wiped off the face of the earth. They don't want more land in Israel. They want every Jewish person on the face of the earth dead, okay? So that's a tough position to back if you have a heart and a mind. Next. To be clear, this is not a retaliatory strike. These are tweets, but the tweets are stretched off past the TV. So whoever's content that I'm stealing right now, I meant to have you on the thing to give you credit. So friggin' back off. To be clear, this is not a retaliatory strike by Iran on Israel. The Iranian regime has considered the destruction of Israel one of its primary tenets since 1979. You know that? Officially, the Iranian regime wants the complete, not just destruction of Israel, the death of every Jewish person as one of its primary tenets since 1979. It established a ring of proxies around Israel, Hamas, Hezbollah, Houthis, whose primary purpose has been to terrorize and attack Israel. So Hamas, so here's what they're doing. You can bring it back to me. Instead of Israel attacking, Iran attacking Israel, which would immediately launch Armageddon or World War III, whatever you want to call it, they decided to fund terrorist groups that attack them for them. So it would be like, instead of me punching your mom, I pay somebody to punch your mom. And then that way, and that person doesn't really have any power. You know, it's not like you can go after the Houthi rebels and seize their assets unless you want a bunch of 1984 Toyota Tacoma pickup trucks and some headscarves. So, you can't do sanctions against the Houthis. So then that's how they fight against Israel. That's where these people get their weapons from. Today is live from Los Angeles, breaking news, Israel, Iran, America, and breaking down the Mark Driscoll and John Lindell altercation, which if you haven't seen that, it's worth taking a look at. One of the craziest things I've ever seen take place in a church service. Next. Iranian regime's attack on Israel, April 13th and April 14th, 2024. 170-plus attack drones, 120-plus ballistic missiles, 30-plus cruise missiles. 99% were intercepted by Israeli air defenses, and I believe the United States helped as well, flew jets and shot them out of the sky. So look at that, 170-plus attack drones, 120-plus ballistic missiles, 30-plus cruise missiles, 99% were intercepted. Does anybody know? I've been meaning to check and haven't. I don't think there was any fatalities. I think one of Israel's bases got hit and some equipment got destroyed, but that is like phenomenal. When a major country like Iran launches a barrage of missile strikes and there's not an injury in your whole country, but I could be wrong. So if there are injuries, let me know if anybody passed away. I'll walk my comments back. Next. Hey, Kevin, good to see you. Okay, this is Pauly Market Bet Odds. Israel's odds of retaliation down to 16%. So if you want to bet on this, which I'm not, obviously not advocating as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, but I do like looking at these because it can be fairly accurate because the people aren't biased. Like if you bet money, it's not about whether you like Iran or like Israel. You want to win your bet. So it kind of cuts through all the nonsense. So it's down, the bettors think there's an 84% chance that Israel will not retaliate by Friday. And only a 16% chance that they will, which I fully expected to wake up this morning and the stock market be down like, you know, my portfolio be down like 14%, 8%. And it hasn't happened. It's all quiet, but I would not be so quick to write off that. I mean, it's by Friday. I think the chance of Israel not doing anything is like zero. Next. Justin found this interesting. There's no article because this is it. This is all there is out on it right now. The FBI has opened criminal investigation. The FBI has opened criminal investigation into Baltimore Bridge collapse, according to the Associated Press. So turning out it may not have been an accident, as we suspected. Next. Brother, I'd love to hear your thoughts about the fiasco at the men's conference and Mark Driscoll. You will hear that at the end. Next. A question I had in December. So when I was watching all those rockets get launched, this was interesting to me. What are the odds Hamas, Hezbollah, I left out the Houthis, destroy Al-Aqsa Mosque themselves with an errant rocket, paving the way for the new temple? So back to me. The third temple has to be built for a lot of Bible prophecy to be fulfilled. That's where the Antichrist is going to do the abomination of desolation. And the problem is Israel would like to rebuild it, but one of the holiest sites in Islam, the Dome of the Rock, is on that land. And so how is that mosque going to go away? I've been thinking as they do these attacks. At first, when I did the tweet, it was the PLO, and then now it's other groups or Iran. You know, it's not like they have the most accurate firing systems. So they're just, you know, as you saw, 99% got intercepted. It's not like Hamas has laser-guided technology. They don't, they have like 19, Hamas and the Houthi rebels basically have the same technology as your opening loadout character when you buy the new Call of Duty game, like all the worst weapons. So all Israel would really have to do is let one through that was headed, because if you're just indiscriminately firing at Israel, they could just let one through that's gonna hit Dome of the Rock. And I don't know that Israel has the technology to know exactly where a missile is going to hit and then let it through, but I wouldn't be surprised if they do have that technology. So just a thought. Next. Oh, we got, things are not stretched now. Love seeing this play out as I'm filing my taxes. My tax dollars, somehow also my tax dollars. Yep, the U.S. funds both sides because we gave billions of dollars to Iran and then we also help Israel, so... You're not really helping. Next. Oh, wow. The Kingdom of Saudi Arabia came out and said it. I found this interesting. Saudi official says Iran engineered war in Gaza to ruin normalization with Israel. An unnamed official from the Saudi royal family tells the Khan public broadcaster that any suspicious object that enters Saudi Arabian airspace is intercepted. An apparent nod towards the kingdom's alleged role in shooting down Iranian attack drones headed for Israel last night. So Saudi Arabia, that's looking to do business, Saudi Arabia has relaxed a lot of its extremist Islamic positions because they like to do business with the West. And so you can keep it up. They apparently help shoot down Iranian missiles. There's a lot that you read that most of the other Arab countries think Iran is nuts and will not back them in a war with Israel, which is good news if you don't want World War III. But, unfortunately, you have this pesky Bible that tells you that it is all going to go down. It's just a matter of when. The Saudi official also criticized Iran for having engineered a war in Gaza in order to destroy the progress it was making in normalizing relations with Israel. Iran is a country that sponsors terrorism, and it should have been stopped a long time ago. That's a Saudi Arabian official reporting that. Next. The Arab nations are not going to, here it is. This is what I mentioned. I forgot I sent it in. The Arab nations are not going to fight a war for Iran. Most of them hate the Iranian regime more than the Israelis, even if they can't say it publicly in Arabic. They'll make noise, but they won't get involved past that. Fingers crossed that my optimistic friends, but I have heard that Iran is considered like the crazy uncle by the rest of the Arab nations. If you're watching from Iran, I'm just reporting the news. Please leave my family alone. Next. Middle East 2020. There he is, the man that's going to start World War III, the most destructive person on earth, Donald Trump, with everybody. Can you see the picture big? If not, no problem. With everybody at the table. Some lady that wandered in from a St. Patrick's Day dinner. And then 2024, under Captain Dementia. Next. Ironically, it's possible the Russia-Ukraine war, this is an interesting take. I like this guy. I hope I get to meet him in real life one day. Ironically, it's possible the Russia-Ukraine war could save us from World War III. Now, obviously in the Bible, we know there's no getting saved from it. This is going to go down, but it could save us from it right now. If Russia had never attacked Ukraine and, it's a little early in the morning for that kind of language, right? And given away so much of its military strength, it would have been in a position to fight alongside Iran. But now it's depleted and unlikely to fight two wars simultaneously. Fingers crossed that Daniel Burr is correct. Next. Iran backed a rare good tweet from Eric Erickson, who generally is a complete dummy. Iran backed and trained Hamas before October 7th. Everyone saying this is an Iranian response to Israel's bombing of Iran's embassy is missing that Israel bombed the embassy because those inside had helped Hamas on October 7th. This is what war looks like. Okay, let me read this one more time. Get my head around it as I await my coffee. Any estimates on when the coffee will arrive? Iran backed and trained Hamas before October 7th. Everyone is saying this is an Iranian response to Israel's bombing of Iran's embassy is missing the point that Israel bombed the embassy because those inside had helped Hamas on October 7th. Okay, so it's not the best worded tweet. So you can bring it back to me. Basically, what he's saying is they're saying that Iran is retaliating. They just skip all the October 7th stuff. They're saying Iran is doing this to Israel. The Iranian apologists say Iran is doing this to Israel because Israel did an act of war when they bombed, a consulate office, as if they just did it. But they did a specific embassy that was holding Iranian members who helped back the attack on October 7th. And, I don't think I can show it on YouTube, but it wouldn't be the worst idea on Check the News one night when we're not on this communist platform called YouTube to show what happened October 7th. It's not like Israel's all worked up over nothing. You had terrorists storm the border and just walk through neighborhoods and kill everybody. Music festival, kill children in front of the parents. If you watch what happened on October 7th, you really can't get me upset about anything Israel does in response. Next. Thanks, Margaret. Thanks for the comments, everybody. We live in an enchanted moment. Interesting. This is actual footage. Roll it. What's up, Pastor Ray? Good to see you on Twitter. So look at that amazing technological advancement, and then you read the comments underneath, and here's what people have to say. Would be cooler with a chainsaw or minigun. There's Panos Karabalos, if you need him, with the Greek perspective. Imagine looking at that amazing achievement to help a lady that's lost her arm and wanting to turn her into a, what was that? A Gears of War character. Good tweet. Next. Just in, first photo of President Trump in courtroom for his criminal trial released. The men in the arena. I would like to, I didn't have time to prep for this tomorrow, but I would like to look at analysis on that case of which way it's going to go. Man, that's a tough thing to go through anytime, let alone when you're, what's he now, 78? Heading up on 80 years old, have to put up with all this. That would wear people out in their 30s. Next. Okay, so as I was tipped off on Thursday, here it is right on schedule. A pro-Palestinian mob is blocking the road to O'Hare International Airport, forcing angry passengers to ditch their cars. Roll it. You got to be joking me that... Pause. Anybody besides me more upset that they're still wearing masks than that they're blocking the highway and supporting Palestine? I can't take it. You're outside. Okay, so you're protecting your health, sitting Indian style in the middle of a freeway, but you want to make sure you block any COVID particles with a mask. I don't understand the thought process of the people who back Hamas. Play it from the beginning. Play it. You can keep rolling it. I want to take another look. Pause it. These are people abandoning their cars to not miss their flight. Now, as they pan, is that not Chicago police that's behind the protesters just parked there? Continue. This is insane. Yeah, pause. What the, how? That to me, that's the most infuriating, not to me, that is the most infuriating part of the whole thing. How do you have Chicago police there backing the protesters? So if you go over and kick one of them in the head and move the barriers, then you get arrested. That's lawlessness. That is criminal. How do you serve on the Chicago Police Department and park your car there? You should quit the force. I know the answer. The answer is that the mayor and your district attorney are backing the protesters. So what, you're going to be a little patsy and sit there and help the protest to ruin your city? To keep your stupid job that makes like what? What does a Chicago police officer make? Is it really worth it? What is the upside of being a Chicago police officer? You have to back these people. If you arrest any criminals and harm them in any way, you get arrested. Unbelievable. Good to see you, Russell Johnson, on X. Continue. Pause. A justified middle finger. Ugh. Look at this lady. I mean, if you're going to back Palestine, can you at least throw on a proper outfit? Have you seen my black hoodie, my jeans, my mom jeans? My old sneakers and my head wrap. You don't really look like you're fully committed to the cause. You look like you joined like 10 seconds ago. Continue. All right. So every election year, you're starting to get, starting what, in 2016, you're starting to get highways blocked. And, I don't understand why you have to put up with that. They're doing something illegal. Why are the police backing them? Someone should invent. Does anybody know about that stuff they have you can get in your car that it clears deer off the road because it emits like a high frequency? Somebody should make something that's like a less lethal thing that you can push a button in your car. And whether it's a sound it emits, I don't know. There should be some Batmobile stuff that's invented where the car does something to clear the road. Tear gas, you would get in trouble. I mean, that's like, that's felony. But if you did some type of piercing noise that you wouldn't be able to trace it, somebody that develops that, you're sitting on a gold mine. But again, don't let me stop every Christian from opening a coffee shop instead. Next. Pro-Palestinian protesters have shut down the Golden Gate Bridge. This is the taxes you pay in this toilet of a city and then have to put up with this. You have to wait, you have to head to work the moment your car hits the driveway from the night before to fight traffic, and then you have this. What is the upside of living? I've never understood why Danny Tanner lived there. Joey Gladstone, Uncle Jesse. I don't see the draw. They ruined San Francisco, one of the most beautiful cities in the world, is this now. Roll it. Play it again. I was so relaxed when I started doing this program, and I'm starting to get irritated. Play. There's the police with the whole bridge shut down. Why? Why do we have to back these 11? 1, 2, 3, 4. They should be laying in the water with broken ribs. Why? Why is this tolerated? Whoever the district attorney is should go to prison. Whoever the mayor is should be brought in, brought up on charges. And that song you came up with, Free Palestine, I mean, can you have some creativity? Sound like my daughter's fourth grade band class. If you're trying to get people on the Palestinian side, who votes for Joe Biden? I know I'm not allowed to publicly endorse a candidate, but I never read anything in the Johnson Amendment that I can't publicly say one of the candidates is trash. How do you vote for this? Why do you like this as being part of America? Nikki Hayes said, the way I would plow right through those cars. But the thing is, you would go to jail. They would charge you. I mean, that guy is in police custody awaiting trial that subdued a guy that was physically assaulting people on the subway in New York. He put him in a chokehold. So that's what they want. They want everybody to just allow and keep your head down and film it. And I couldn't do it. I would find a third option. Next. Oklahoma Republican senator. This is what makes it hard to back Republicans. This guy, also, the guy has a stupid name. If you want to be Mark Wayne, there should be a space between the K and the W should be capitalized. You can't have a first name that's Mark Wayne. Okay? It's as irritating as the blocking of the highway. Oklahoma Republican Senator Mark Wayne Mullins purchased. His mom and dad got in an argument. One wanted Mark, one wanted Wayne, and then they just went with the combined Mark Wayne. Mark Wayne Mullins' purchase of Raytheon, which was disclosed on April 13th, 2023, has increased 41% since the time of his purchase. Senator Mullins sits on the Senate Armed Services Committee, which, of course, is a major conflict of interest. So these people don't change anything. He finds out there's going to be a conflict, and instead of stopping it, just buys stock in Raytheon that goes up in times of war. Next. Jerk. Okay, and here we go. This is what you people asked for. Steve Deese, Ron DeSantis apologist. What in the literal hell? Good for Driscoll for calling it out. So I'm going to show you what happened, and we'll do a little breakdown of the film after. Megachurch has strip show-like performance at men's conference. Guest speaker Mark Driscoll spoke out against it and was kicked off stage. Unbelievable that any church would allow this. Reason number 538, not to attend the megachurch. Yes, because if somebody does something wrong, then you write, look, I found a fly in my soup. Reason 538, to never eat food. This is one megachurch that did this. Now, I'm saying this because a lot of times if I've played clips like this, they're nobodies or people I don't know. I don't know either of these guys, but I know who they are. John Lindell, from everything I've heard, has a great church called James River in Missouri. And Mark Driscoll had a strong church in Washington State. And then his board turned against him. And then he started over again in Scottsdale. So these are well-known guys. And this is what happened at their men's conference. So we'll go from top left to top right to bottom left to bottom right. I'll watch it through with you one time without commentary, and then we'll break it down. This is at a men's conference. Roll it. I said I was going to watch it through without. I will. Okay, continue. Sword swallower seems accurate. Back to me real quick. I just needed a break. Watch the rest. I'm starting to realize why our church has grown. You know what I think men like at men's conference? Let's get some shirtless guy to swallow swords on a stripper pole. Shirtless. What do you guys say? That's what men are longing for. Go to any Bass Pro Shop or Cabela's. There's just shirtless dudes swallowing swords, working the pole. I mean, and I don't know where this was being held. I know Pastor John Lindell's church is in Missouri, like Springfield, Missouri, where Bass Pro Shop was founded. Do you really think the Missouri rednecks are craving that? I don't know that anyone is. I definitely don't think they are there. And again, I know of John. I don't interpret any of my comments. Why don't you like John Lindell? Don't write something like, John Lindell's a good guy. I know he is. We're just having a little fun getting our heads around what happened. I can't believe there's more of this. How many more seconds of this is there? What the heck? You know what's funny is like those type of ministers would never do stuff like I do. Like they would never do the Tupac Back to Cali AI promo video. That's too far. But the shirtless male stripper for the men's conference, who's listed as a sword swallower. Holy moly. I don't know. Continue. Pause. It was 5 inches from being a good ending to the video. He stopped just short. It would have been great to just see it go straight through his skull. How much more time? Holy moly, 25 more seconds. All right. Random Suzuki motorcycle. People are rushing for the exit. All right. So I said we're going to watch it through one time, and then we'll break down the film. So let's go to the next one. Because it's not over, my friend. Exclusive, how a dirt poor bad boy from a sleepy Moldovan town, as opposed to the hustling and bustling Moldovan towns, became a seedy Las Vegas stripper, as opposed to the high-class Las Vegas strippers, before wowing millions as BGT's daredevil sword swallower. So Alex Magala stunned the audience of Britain's Got Talent, former male stripper, doing what he has to do to pay the bills. And somebody looked at this and said, we got to get this guy in for our men's conference. Did they have time for him to lay hands on the men, impart his spirit? Next. All right, pause. So they have Mark Driscoll as a guest speaker, okay? So all that was just background for what actually is the news story. So they introduce Mark Driscoll to speak. Roll it from the beginning.
We're going to talk about how to be an Elijah, yeah, and how to deal with they have a Jezebel. But let me do this. I've been up since 1 o'clock in the morning. The reason I'm hoarse is I have been praying for you, and my heart is very burdened for you. And I want to be very careful with this, and it's not what I want to say, but the Jezebel spirit has already been here. The Jezebel spirit opened our event. This is a rebuke and a correction of no one. This is an observation. Before the word of God was open, there was a platform. It was a high place. On it was a pole, an asherah. The same thing that's used in a strip club for women who have the Jezebel spirit to seduce men. In front of that was a man who ripped his shirt off like a woman does in front of a pole at a strip club. That man then ascended. See, our God is not arrogant. He doesn't ascend. Our God is humble. He descends. And then he swallowed a sword, and Jesus cried, okay, Pastor John, I'll receive that. Thank you.
Pause. So if you're going to hear, that's the voice that's yelling. You're done. We'll break it down on the film, but so that was him yelling. He said, all right, I'll receive it. And he packed up his stuff. He said, you're done. No problem. Took his stuff and left. Continue. Okay, then the last clip. So then he leaves. Oh, here it is. So I'll break it down. But you're out of line, Mark. And then he keeps going. He says, you're done. Continue.
Okay, Pastor John, I'll receive that. Thank you.
Wow.
zuschauer. Die Lieder. Wow. Amen.
Let me just say this.
Yes, we have shown. Wow.
If Mark wanted to say that, he should have said it to me first. He didn't. Matthew 18. Matthew 18. If your brother offends you, go to him privately. I talked to Mark for a half hour. There was not one word of that. He's out of line. If he wanted to say it, he could say it to me. You may not agree with me. You may not agree with him. But we are brothers in Christ, and there's a right way to handle disagreement.
Play that last clip one more time.
We're going to talk about how to be an Elijah. And how to deal with they have a Jezebel. But let me do this. I've been up since 1 o'clock in the morning. The reason I'm hoarse is I have been praying for you and my heart is very burdened for you. And I want to be very careful with this, and it's not what I want to say. But the Jezebel spirit has already been here. The Jezebel spirit opened our event. This is a rebuke and a correction of no one. This is an observation. Before the word of God was open, there was a platform. It was a high place. On it was...
No, the last clip, the fourth one.
An Asherah. The same thing that's used in the strip club for women who have the Jezebel spirit to seduce men. In front of that was a man.
The last clip, the fourth one, the one that shot
like
from up high.
In front of a pole, and stripped. Then he swallowed a sword, and Jesus cried, okay, Pastor John, I'll receive that. Thank you.
Let me just say this.
Yes, we have shown.
Wow. If Mark wanted to say that, he should have said it to me first. He did. Matthew 18. Matthew 18. If your brother offends you, go to him privately. I talked to Mark for a half hour. There was not one word of that. He's out of line. If he wanted to say it, he could say it to me. You may not agree with me. You may not agree with him. But we are brothers in Christ, and there's a right way to handle disagreement.
All right. So let's go from the first clip, and then now break. By the way, before we start, this is not, I will never in my whole life be a commenter on church things that criticizes and says who's in the wrong and the right. Just going to break down a little film for you. I'm sure I've never met John Lindell. I've never heard anything bad about him. I don't know Mark Driscoll. I've never met him. But I know he's very strong on morality stuff. You know, he doesn't cave to LGBT stuff and all that in his preaching. He doesn't have a woke church. So I don't have a problem with either guy. We're just going to break this down. And I wish Faith Shropshire, that's on the commenting, I wish we could break it down together, because I feel like we would have a lot of fun. First one. Okay, so now we'll start breaking down the film. Okay, I don't know why. I guess once a stripper, always a stripper. But it's just positive. It's just odd at a Christian men's conference in Missouri. Look at the guy all the way on the left with the white hair and the white goatee. Like, when he went for a front row seat, I don't think that was in any way what he was gunning for. You just picture him. What's that, his son next to him? What's that guy removing his shirt? What's going on exactly? I think we might have to leave. Want to head out to Andy's Custard? I don't, look, and he's eyeing him. The stripper roots coming out. Strong eye contact with the old Assemblies of God guy in the front row as he removes his shirt. Ugh. Continue. Okay. Limited flexibility. I mean, better than me. Not circus. Oh, here comes the sewer. Okay. Again, keep bear in mind these are Bass Pro Shop type people. It's dead quiet. People are squirmy a little bit. Okay. Impressive laps. Licking the sore. One guy's clapping. So we discovered the gay guy that snuck into the men's conference. Okay. A collective WTF from the crowd. You look at him, it's like if WTF was a group of people. Pause, bring it back to the one guy that clapped, kind of outed himself. Back to me. Wait, what are you doing, Joe?
No, I just got an ESPN update that the Brewers took the lead in the baseball game.
How about those Bears? Continue. Oh, my God. Anybody else rooting for a slip? More people outing themselves. This is the drama team sitting in the bed. Back it up 15 seconds. Wait, what do you get started to pause? The aforementioned older white guy with white hair and white beard with his son sitting next to him. Watch the son when he lands. I think he swung him from straight to gay by the end. When he goes to the gay. Oh, I hope Jesus comes soon. I'm actually looking forward to this place getting burned to the ground. When Jesus comes back on the white horse, I'm going to be behind him going like this. Burn it more. Burn it again. Can we burn it again? Continue. Watch the kid. He falls in love live on camera. I like guys now. He's still clapping. His grandfather is wondering what went wrong. We should have gone fishing. Still clapping. And he turned the whole crowd gay. Not bad. Pretty impressive the more you watch it. For a guy to turn and look, and then the guys that remain straight heading for the exits quickly. I'm going to try to go to a monster truck rally real quick to just cleanse the gay palate. Next. By the way, if you're watching from the LGBT community, I'm a big ally. So this guy, how a dirt poor bad boy. Bad boy. How a dirt poor bad boy, in quotes. So apparently, did they cite the source of who he's called a bad boy from? From a sleepy Moldovan town became a seedy Vegas stripper before wowing millions.
as Britt Gusmus's Daredevil sword swallower. Okay, back to me. So that's Alex Magala, if you need him. The thing that's shocking to me, maybe the most shocking of the whole thing, is not joking around, I would pay no more than $14,500 to have footage of the board of the group meeting with the media team, assistant pastors and pastors when they were planning this event, when somebody put the dossier on the table to the church board and stuff and ran through the pros and cons of having a gay stripper to swallow swords at a Missouri men's conference. Let me tell you, if they could find whoever successfully pitched that to an Assemblies of God church, they should have them negotiate the Iranian-Israeli peace accord. Because if you could... Now listen, hear me out, Pastor. I mean, imagine just starting your pitch out. Okay, listen, I know we're looking for the new events for the men's conference. Hear me out on this. There's a gay stripper, former Vegas gay stripper. Hold on. I know that might hit a few people the wrong way. Hear me out. He swallows literal swords. And I was thinking maybe we'd get a giant pole, have him take his shirt off while maintaining eye contact with some of our older members, put the sword in his mouth, climb to the top, and then finish with a big where he almost dies. Think of this. You would think, even if you were okay with all that, just the potential liability. It's not like this guy's David Copperfield with some big resume. What was to stop him from slipping on the pole? I mean, the thing's basically on a glorified ping pong table. And he goes and dies live on stage, and you get sued, and you become an enemy of the nation of Moldova. What? I just would like to know, the Ben Franklin, draw a line down the center of the page, list the pros and list the cons. What are the pros? I can name a lot of cons. I would pay 14,000. I want to do 15. I'd do 14,500 if I could have the footage and audio of the guy that pitched that to the church board. And then think of this. This is an Assemblies of God church in Missouri. So he gets done. So listen, this guy's a gay stripper. Or I don't know if he's gay. He's a male stripper. That's what I meant to say. He's a male stripper, and he swallows swords, and we have him climb a pole and do that in front of our audience. What do you say? And they all look around. One guy reaches for a donut. No, I like this, you know. I feel like we'll reach a new audience. Oh, my man. Where's that from? There's a Dunkin' here in L.A.? God bless you, bro. Thanks, bro. I'm really going to enjoy. If you guys feel like, oh, my God, just when the day looked like it was going good, this paper straw. Let me tell you something, L.A. Take your paper straws. I'd rather drink a drink through somebody else's used washcloth than use a... I'd rather go on a road trip with that Moldovan sword swallower than use a paper straw. Now listen, I know I've run this video long. You're welcome to log off at any time. The rest of this video is basically for me to enjoy myself with a nice coffee and watch a Moldovan sword swallower ruin a ministry relationship and destroy a men's conference. Who could have foreseen that being the result? I mean, gee, that must have come out of nowhere. It looks like that would be something that would be really good. Imagine having to preach after that anyway. How many feel the anointing in here? Let's just lift our hands as the Moldovan sword swallower exits the building to get his chest oiled up and put his nipple ring back in. Let's just lift our hands as we head to the service now, as we head to the ministry part of the men's conference. Okay, so somebody pitched this. It went through. Let's move on. What's the third one? No, we saw that. Then there's Mark. Yes.
We're going to talk about how to be an Elijah and how to deal with Ahab and Jezebel.
Before we deal with how Mark Driscoll handled it, and you can give your comments on how you feel it should be handled. What are your options here if you're speaking next? A, pretend like nothing happened. Hallelujah. Isn't he good? Not the Moldovan stripper guy. I'm talking about the Lord. Just pretend like, here's your options. Because I've been in situations similar to this, but never that bad. Especially when you start off in the ministry and you're doing youth stuff and like they were playing Chubby Bunny with marshmallows and a kid vomited and then one, another one almost choked to death and had to be resuscitated. Then they swing it to you. All right. How many are glad Timmy's alive still and the other kid's going to be all right that vomited the marshmallows? So, well, let's head to the word. So you can ignore it. That's right, Austin. You can pretend it didn't happen. You could... Vessel of Honor Ministry said, did Mark Driscoll know beforehand this would be happening? No way to know. I know as much as you know. I don't know. Can you see if we can get Mark Driscoll on tomorrow morning? Contact and say that I'd like to talk to him about things from his perspective. And that it's not, tell him it won't be an ambush interview or anything. I want to get to the bottom of this. This is my new passion. This is a little passion project for old John. So, A, you can ignore it. B, Nathan said, why don't we just preach Jesus? You know, I'm looking into starting to preach full time. But for right now, I'm just going to take the morning and dissect men's conference stripper videos. You could ignore it. What's option two? You could rebuke it like he did. Option three, I guess those are your only two options. No, option three, you could ignore it, you could rebuke it, or you could leave. Leaving is the diplomatic, like if you were really grieved, like, and I don't think Mark Driscoll's being not telling the truth. I think he really did not enjoy that. The diplomatic thing would be to leave and say, I'm sorry, I'm not preaching after that, and you could leave. But I don't know if you're wrong to address it. Now, I will tell you, ministerial ethics-wise, you don't do that. I'm not saying he shouldn't have, but I'm telling you, you don't correct what a pastor did in his church. You know, that's like, that's going to end. Any pastor that has any weight at all is going to take the mic back from you if you correct him and what he does in his church. But I don't know that you're in that case. I mean, like, if you feel something was so grievous that you feel like you'd be betraying yourself to stay quiet about it, then the other thing I want to tell you is, I think this is okay. Let's watch it, and then I'm going to say one more thing about it. Roll it.
And how to deal with they have a Jezebel.
Don't love the outfit.
But let me do this. I've been up since 1 o'clock
Pause.
In the morning.
That outfit looks to me like how Steve Harvey would dress casually if he was white. But anyway, it's not important. Let's keep going.
The reason I'm hoarse is I have been praying for you, and my heart is very burdened for you.
Pause.
I want to be
back to me, and then if you can keep it paused there. I will say, if he's telling the truth and he's been praying since 1 a.m. for the thing, you would be your only chance as a speaker of like not saying anything would be like if you pulled an old John and service started at 10 a.m. and you set your alarm for 9:57 and grabbed half a Twix bar and a Diet Coke and headed to the platform. Then maybe you'd be in such a fog that it wouldn't really bother you. But if you had prayed from 1 a.m. till when that service started, your spirit would be super sensitive, and it would like you'd be ticked. Like if he was praying, Lord, bless this conference, bless these men, use me to impact lives, and you were getting in the presence of God, and you were like going in there to like hit it, and that happened. You would, it would turn you like Old Testament. Continue.
very careful with this, and it's not what I want to say.
Oh, is that true, Rachel?
But the Jezebel spirit has already been here.
Breaking news from Rach Romero on YouTube. Mark and John had a sit-down on stage after where Mark apologized for the rebuke. Okay, they probably didn't allow filming. If anybody can find that footage to put a nice bow on this broadcast, I would love to see that. Because I'm sure they're not, they're principled men, but they're not like, they're not the kind that are going to hate each other. Austin said he couldn't. I could not find video of it, but people who were there, the crowd got so unruly, storming out. Pastor John brought Pastor Mark to discuss. Oh, in the same meeting? They talked about how to disagree, so they tried to save it. Well, Kristen, we don't know if it was an apology for sure. Kyle, you saw it? Somebody's got to get the video to us. And again, I'm not taking sides on this. I'm on my own side, which is just observing. I like both those guys. Oh, so Andre in South Africa said, I think it happened the day before he preached. The pastor of the church said, no, because they could have been speaking in the green room while that was going on, because it's not like the pastor and the guest speaker don't always like go out for the whole service. So they could have been backstage and seen it and him never mention it, which that is a little... That's the only part that is a little suspect. But this, well, I'll get into it. I think, you know, there's a verse in the Bible, know those that labor among you. If you had a really good relationship with somebody, you're not going to do that. But if you're just having in guys to speak at your men's conference, and I do that, you know, at What No I Has Seen this year, that'll be the first time I've ever met Robert Kyanja in person. It'll be the first time I've ever met Matthew Ashimaloa. So there isn't... But I know their ministry and they know my ministry. But I think when you have a conference and just pull all kinds of people in, then it kind of opens it to this sort of thing happening. Oh, we have links to the video? Kyle Dross sent it on Facebook. So let's see if we can get it. Tell the floor man, my buddy here to my right, if you get it. Okay, let's watch the wherever we left off.
The Jezebel spirit opened our event. This is a rebuke and a correction of no one. This is an observation. Before the word of God was open, there was a platform. It was a high place. On it was a pole.
Oh, you're in Arizona, Howard. I love where he pastors in Scottsdale. I feel like if I pastored in Scottsdale, I would just turn to jelly. I would like be the least motivated person. Such a beautiful place. I don't think you have to go into this breakdown about the Ashtera poll and all that. I think you just say, like, hey, listen, everybody, that was super gay. Continue.
The same thing that's used in the strip club for women who have the Jezebel spirit to seduce men. In front of that was a man who ripped his shirt off like a woman does in front of a pole.
Pause. That part's pretty hard to defend. Like, what he's saying there, rip it, you know, because that was just straight up stripping. And again, it almost would be less offensive if it was a woman at a men's conference doing that, not to rip the whole shirt off. But I'm saying, like, a man, I don't know. That was like... You know, I've been being sarcastic and joking, trying to have a little fun, but it is wild that made it through, because those churches don't run things like we run things at our church, where basically I just have an idea and we do it. It goes through people, and there's departments. It's a huge church. I mean, it has to be run like that. So it is insane to me that made it through a bunch of people. Who's this guy that's coming to the stage? Never seen him before. He's a Moldovan stripper. But he doesn't just strip, he swallows swords. All right, put him on. What's the worst that can... I guess this video answers the question, what's the worst that can happen? When people always throw that out there, hey, what's the worst that can happen? That's the worst that can happen. Continue.
That man then ascended. See, our God is not arrogant. He doesn't ascend. Our God is humble. He descends. And then he swallowed a sword.
Pause. Out of line, Mark. That's Pastor John. So back it up a little bit. You'll hear that. Out of line, Mark. That's a good question, Rach Romero. Who had the Moldovan stripper's contact information? Because that's a good point. We need to get to the bottom of this because there's major problems, major potential problems. Hey, does anybody have an idea for upcoming night conference? I know a Moldovan male stripper. I don't have any ideas. Continue. Great.
He swallowed a sword, and Jesus Christ. Okay, Pastor John, I'll receive that. Thank you.
Pause. Out of line, Mark. You're done. All right, I'll see that. Now, I will say this. If anybody thinks, and I don't have a dog in this fight, because I like both dogs that are in the fight. If you think what Mark did was out of line, Pastor Mark, that part of it was not out of line. Because where he would have crossed the line is when Pastor John yelled out of line, Mark, you're done. If he'd went, no, I'm not done. I'm just getting, if he recapped the Al Pacino speech from the end of Son of the One, I'm just getting warmed up. If I was the man I was, half the man I was 5 years ago, I'd take a flamethrower to this place. If he just went full Al Pacino, Son of a Woman at that point, it would have been a better video. But, that's where, the fact that when the head pastor shut it down, I don't know. The more I think about it, it's hard to go against Pastor Mark Driscoll, because he might have thought he was correcting it on behalf of John Lindell. Do you know what I mean? Like, obviously John Lindell did not like this. So instead of him having to deal with it, I'll rebuke it. Maybe. I don't know, but maybe not, because Pastor John Lindell sure didn't take it that way. He took it as, you're like undermining my authority in my own church. You're out of line, Mark. You're done. And when he says that, he says, okay, I received that, and takes his stuff and exits the stage. Is there more left to that video before we go to the other one? 3 seconds. I'll watch the last 3 seconds. Okay, so then at that point, it's bad. Because when you have a speaker like Pastor Mark, there's a bunch of people that don't go to James River Church, which is why the whole reason you have in somebody like Mark Driscoll. He's been on Fox News a lot lately. He's had an impactful ministry for a long time. So there's people that come to the conference that they don't know John Lindell, and they don't really know James River Church. They like Mark Driscoll. So it'd be like how, like, let's say I was preaching somewhere, which has happened, and somebody threw me out, and you came to hear me preach, and they started rebuking me, it would cause a problem, because you actually don't even know who that pastor is or the church, and there would be people that are like barely saved or upset that would just start yelling out. Well, at this point, the men's conference is ruined, because it's going to turn into a very unchristian event, because now there's booing and people yelling at the pastor, and that's where it's bad. I mean, now, do I have a way it should have been handled? Obviously, from the point that the stripper got on stage, can you believe you even have to, like, as a preacher, sentences I never thought I would utter. You know where I feel the church service went wrong was probably when the stripper got on stage. Once you allowed that to happen and didn't say anything, that's where it's going to be a problem, like a major problem. So then Mark said something. Which, again, the more I look at it from Mark Driscoll's perspective, is he taking a little bit of flack now? Yeah, but would he have taken more flack if he ignored it? That he's really going to ruin, I don't want to use like secular marketing terms, but Pastor Mark Driscoll is going to ruin his whole brand, because he's standing up for the church, standing up for like Bible ministry. So if you go preach after that and don't say anything, then you kind of have like caved. It'd be like me speaking after Dr. Fauci gave a message on masks, then I just get up, wasn't he great, everybody? And then it's like, what happened to Jonathan? He sold out. So I don't know. He couldn't not do what he did in a way. So then, now what do you do if you're Pastor John Lindell? speakers out. People are starting to boo. It probably is setting in on you a little bit that this is a horror show. You know, this is bad. And so he gets up to salvage it, and we'll break down that clip. Go ahead.
And then he swallowed a sword, and Jesus Christ, okay, Pastor John, I'll receive that. Thank you.
Pause. Now there's clapping and booing. I don't know what people are clapping for. Maybe it's the stripper's family. Thank you for sticking up for our son. He's trained very hard. He's done a lot of sword swallowing, and this was his big chance. And this pastor from Scottsdale was going to ruin my son's thing. So thanks for sticking. I don't know why. A lot of church people are like clapping seals. They'll clap for anything. What's to clap for there? You could be quiet or boo, but there's really nothing to applaud. Continue. Pause. Now the boos are starting to overwhelm the clapping. What a thing to attend. Can anybody find out if there was tickets for this? I'm guessing there was. How much you had to pay? Because however much you had to pay to be at this, it wasn't enough. If you'd have known this stuff was going to go down, you could have charged like 30 grand a ticket. Continue. Pause. Oof. I've never heard a preacher be on stage and heard the crowd yell out, get off the platform. And it's his event. You know, who would have known that the rednecks of rural Missouri would have sided against the male stripper? So you took, you made the choice to throw Mark out, which de facto sides you with the male stripper. And apparently the men of Missouri don't like that. And they yelled, get off the platform. That's bad. You know, that's really bad. That's like, as much as I'm just kind of joking around and making light of it, it is like grievous a little bit that you're having what's supposed to be a church service. And it sounds like a, you know, like a Democrat rally with people just yelling at each other and stuff. So according to Rachel Schran on YouTube, it was 120 a person. Well, you got your money's worth. You definitely couldn't like sue to get your money back because you definitely got a show. 119 to 199, depending on what kind of ticket you got. Can anybody expound on that? What came with the 199 ticket? Photo with male stripper? For real, what was? I'm always interested at the place, at the people that charge money to come here. People preach. What comes with the higher end ticket? Somebody said, Leanne, bring your ones. What a mess. All right, continue.
If Mark wanted to say that, he should have said it to me first.
Pause. If Mark wanted to say that to me, he should have said it to me first. Then he's going to quote Matthew 18, which is, if you have a problem with a brother, go to him privately. I heard this last night. I've been thinking about that. Yeah, if you have a problem with a brother, go to him privately. That I don't know how much that applies to this situation because he was rebuking that Moldovan guy and what he did, which in doing that, you're also kind of rebuking the guy that put the event on. But I don't know that's not like he has a problem. It's not like he went up there and went, I got a problem with some of the things John Lindell says and does. And I'm going to tell it to you right now. He didn't do that. He was addressing things that go on publicly have to be addressed publicly. Something can't go on publicly and be addressed privately when it's affected the congregation. So I don't know about that. Somebody posted 1 Timothy 5:20, them that sin rebuke before all that others may also fear. I think that scripture would be more apropos than Matthew 18. I don't think that's true, Kevin Mercer. Anybody find out yet what comes with the 199? Maybe you get your photo. No, I would like to. Does anyone, can anybody find what it was? Oh, so it wasn't VIP. $119 early registration, $199 at the door. When you could have just gone to see that guy do the same thing for like a $5 cover charge at a Las Vegas club. Don't ask me why I'm dressed like Dr. Dre today. Continue.
Matthew 18.
Pause.
Matthew 18.
Really covering the whole spectrum of men. Listen, just so everybody feels welcome, we'll have a male stripper and we'll have a big Harley graphic. We want to appeal to everybody. Continue.
If your brother offends you,
I see you.
Go to him privately.
I see you, Johnny Hill.
I talked to Mark for a half hour. There was not one word of that. He's out of line. If you want to say it,
pause.
You can say it to me.
I get things from Pastor John Lindell's perspective. Because it would be weird, like if I was speaking for a pastor and we were back, let's say we were backstage or in the green room or in the front row and we were chatting it up and then I just go on stage and blow up his meeting. You know, it would be weird if, you know, I get that part of it. Like if, could Mark, Pastor Mark have said, are you going to address this or do you want me to address it? I get that from John Lindell's perspective. But again, the more I watch, whoever greenlighted the male stripper, you kind of just don't, I don't know. You got what was coming to you. Good to see you, Josh, in West Virginia. Pastor Josh. Continue.
You may not agree with me. You may not agree with him. But we are brothers in Christ, and there's a right way.
Kristen said, do we know for sure that they spoke before Mark went on? I mean, I don't think John Lindell just outright lie. Somebody wrote, preach, sir. I'm not preaching. I'm for both these guys. I'm positive that if John Lindell had it, Pastor John Lindell had it to do over again, he would have never done that. So I feel bad, you know. I don't know how stuff it is. Somebody said it's a mess. That's what it is. It's a mess. So do we have the apology thing? You do? Okay, so I'm watching this for the first time with you. Here's the fallout.
Said changes that, and Mark and I talked.
Pause.
We went outside when we could.
Okay, so this is the same day. Either that or they wore clothes for two consecutive days. Let's give them the benefit of the doubt. I feel like the chairs are kind of a power play move. It seems like John's is higher, and Mark's in like a high chair type of chair. Guys, for the men's conference, let's get a huge brandless graphic of a motorcycle. Right, Nick? So he says they went backstage and talked. Let me watch it through one time. And then, how long is it? Just a few seconds?
54 seconds.
All right, it's 1 minute. We'll watch it. Then we'll watch it back one time, one third, and break it down like it's Monday after a Sunday football game. We'll break down the film together. This is Jonathan Shuttlesworth live from Los Angeles. Breaking down the Mark Driscoll, Pastor Mark Driscoll, Pastor John Lindell altercation. Roll it.
Said changes that. And Mark and I talked. We went outside where we could be alone and we could talk.
Pause. Play from the beginning and I'll
Mark,
be quiet one time.
I want you to know. Said changes that. And Mark and I talked. We went outside where we could be alone and we could talk. And we've reaffirmed our friendship. And Mark, I want you to know, you're a gift to the kingdom. You're a gift to James River. You've been a gift to Debbie and I. You've helped us in things. You've been kind to my family and to my sons. And I love you. And I told Mark, listen, he says, I'll do whatever you want. I said, well, if you're willing, and we could come in and talk, and we'll let him talk here in a moment. If you're willing, I want you to speak again. I want to find out about Elijah.
Come on!
Most of you have heard me say that I'd have no interest in speaking on the conference circuit, and I'm going to tell you, this video has done not much to change my mind. I mean... Okay. Another clip. We have a second clip. Roll it.
I believe what I should have done since I had another session. I was thinking about it. It wasn't in my notes.
Thanks whoever filmed this with a Motorola Razr. And then Kristen said that there's less drama at women's conferences. Oh, good Lord. All right, play the second clip from the beginning.
I believe what I should have done since I had another session. I was thinking about it. It wasn't in my notes. I didn't intend to go there. I was up late praying for the men. I just kept seeing it. And I should have, between sessions, talked to you rather than just verbal processing on the stage. And as the father and the head of the house, you could have given me a thumbs up or down, and I need to honor that as spiritual authority, and I honor your spiritual authority on this I apologize to you for not going that route, which would have led us from the most awkward moment in the history of any man. And I don't, I mean, if I were you, I wouldn't let me speak again. That's what you're talking about. But Pastor John, when I was at the lowest point of my life, I wasn't sure I was ever going to go into ministry again. I thought, if I do go into ministry, I want to do it with my family, with my wife and kids and daughters. So I flew up and met with you and Debbie, and you sat me down on the couch, and you're like, Here's some thoughts, and we've architected our whole church and ministry in large part on that conversation. And my whole family is blessed, and they're blessed because you and your wife let me sit on your couch. So thank you, and I love you very much.
You're up at one. I was up a little before four. I was praying. I told my sons, I said, I really feel something's going to happen today.
Sorry about that.
I said, but I'm so excited because I feel the Lord is going to do something. Mark, I feel like, you know, what Satan intends at times for evil and always division, even yeah.
I don't want division.
Here's what I'm saying is, what sometimes Christian brothers can feel strongly about things that, and there's a difference. You know, there are some things there have to be differences over.
The things that matter, we agree.
Well, it kind of has a feel to it as if the movie Tombstone ended with Doc Holliday, Wyatt Earp, and Curly Bill Brocious just putting their arm around each other's shoulders and saying, hey, listen, we've had some disagreements. Let's be friends. It's like a pretty anticlimactic thing. We'll break it down and then we'll call it a day. Play those last two clips again.
Said changes that, and I, Mark, and I talked. We went outside where we could be alone, and we could.
You know, again, whispering. Make sure you're recording. They did. They turned the male stripper spirit came into the whole crowd. They're just drama queens recording things with their phone. Make sure you record it. And then, okay, so then that happened. You know, you have to give Pastor Mark Driscoll, by the way, you can nix trying to get him as a... No, you know what? If he'll come on, he'll come on. I'm sure it'll be an entertaining program. But that pretty much settles it. So they're not... I'd like to know what happened in between. So then something took place after Pastor John Lindell got on stage that gave him time to go meet with Mark. I would love to have the footage of that. Hey, what were you doing out there? What was I doing? What are you doing out there? You just had a Moldovan male. Am I getting this right? You had a Moldovan male stripper open for me? I don't think I'm out of line. I think you're out of line. No, with all due respect, I think you're out of line because I'm the father of this house or whatever, whatever kind of terminology you want to use. And then they worked it out. Yeah, I mean, I honestly, I'm surprised because I think I would have just thought Mark would have just headed to the car, Pastor Mark, and been out of there back to Arizona. I can tell you, if I lived in Scottsdale, I'd have been on a plane to Scottsdale like that. But they worked it out, and then they came back. All right, so go ahead with the video.
Talk, and we've reaffirmed our friendship.
Pause.
Mark, I want you to...
Bring it to me. I want everybody that's watching this right now to just make me a promise that if you ever see me sitting by another man and say that we've affirmed our friendship, that you'll kill me. Please. And then save this video and play it. And if this is being played in court right now, I would like to say, Your Honor, they were carrying out my wishes and they should serve no penalty financially or in jail. You die a little inside as a man telling another man I'm affirming our friendship. It makes me feel bad. It makes my insides feel like a used plastic paper straw. Continue.
No. You're a gift to the kingdom. You're a gift to James River. You've been a gift to Debbie and I. You've helped us in things. You've been kind to my family and to my sons. And I love you. And I told Mark, listen, he says, I'll do whatever you want. I said, well, if you're willing,
pause.
And we could come in and talk. And
you know, personally, I feel like for the feng shui of the room, if you are going to have a male stripper in your men's conference, no men can say I love you to another man, at least for the rest of that service. It's too much gay feng shui. You need to balance it out with a little hetero feng. I'll tell you what you should have done. If you're going to do that to balance out the room, you should have had the Moldovan stripper go. Then when you're like, wasn't that great, everybody? Now welcome, Larry the Cable Guy. And then everything would be right. All right, continue.
I'll talk to you in a moment. If you're willing, I want you to speak again. I want to find out about Elijah.
Come on! All right. I mean, it's definitely not... I'm glad everyone's enjoying this. Not the worst way to handle it. You know, you kind of saved the meeting because it was about to break out into a riot when it ended on the video before that. It looked like you're going to have about two-thirds of the people storm out. That is a good point. Why, I'm reading the comments, why was nothing mentioned about, see, like, I feel like you should have united against your common enemy, the stripper. You know, it's not about really you two. It's like, well, how does this guy get off scot-free? You know, they're arguing it out. The crowd's booing. Meanwhile, the Moldovan stripper is getting his chest grease, eating a sliced orange or something. Continue.
I believe what I should have done since I had another session. I was thinking about it. It wasn't in my notes. I didn't intend to go there. I was up late praying for the men. Just kept seeing it, and I should have, between sessions, talked to you rather than just verbal processing on the stage. And as the father and the head of the house, you could have given me a thumbs up or down, and I need to honor that as a spiritual authority. And I honor your spiritual authority.
Pause. You know, I do, because they brought it up a second time. When Mark Driscoll said he was in that room praying all day for the conference, and then Pastor John Lindell said that he was too, and he told his sons, I feel like something's going to happen today. And what's he preaching on? He's getting all fired up to preach on Elijah taking out the Jezebel spirit. Then you go up on stage and the thing that you're tuned up to like go after in the spirit is happening. I gotta say, the more I watch it, the more I see things, Pastor Mark. I totally understand Pastor Mark Driscoll's Andrew, in the comments on YouTube, I don't think the church knew he was a stripper before they booked him. You know, maybe look into it. If you Google his name, it's the first thing that comes up. He was on Britain's Got Talent. Yeah, he said didn't fully vet it. You got to look into that stuff. What are you laughing at, Abraham? That's how you end up with Borat at your church, because nobody looks into anything. Everybody just trusts everybody. All right, keep going.
I apologize to you for not going that route, which would have led us from the most awkward moment in the history of any message.
Yeah, okay.
So, yeah. And I don't, I mean, if I were you, I wouldn't let me speak again. That's what you're talking about. But Pastor John, when I was at the lowest point of my life, I wasn't sure I was ever going to go into ministry again. I thought, if I do go into ministry, I want to do it with my family, with my wife and kids and daughters. So I flew up, I met with you and Debbie, and you sat me down on the couch, and you're like, here's some thoughts. And we've architected our whole church and ministry in large part on that conversation. And my whole family is blessed. And they're blessed because you and your wife let me sit on your couch.
Pause it real quick. Back to how long would it take to get a t-shirt together for today's program? I went to the James River Men's Conference, and all I got was this Moldovan stripper. All right, working on it. Efforting. If we use James River's logo, can we get sued, or is it covered under parody? Are we allowed to use Mark Driscoll and John Lindell's face and likeness without getting sued? But we can't use James River's logo. Okay, so let's use... Why not just close a few more doors for myself before lunchtime? I'll cross two more places off the list. I'll never be asked to speak. An ever-growing list. Okay, so I went to the James River... What was the name of the men's conference?
Stronger Men's Conference.
Okay, we'll do that, because then we won't get sued by James River. Because I'm sure, I just get the feeling they would take up for the stripper before they would see the fun in the t-shirt. I went to the Stronger Men's, what's it called?
Stronger Men's Conference.
The Stronger Men's Conference, and all I saw was a Moldovan stripper. A Moldovan male stripper. We'll do that. And then so have Pastor John Lindell, Pastor Mark Driscoll, and then just the face of the Moldovan stripper. And as you help us preach the gospel tonight in Los Angeles, that will be our thank you gift for those who give today. I probably need some sleep, but we're going to go with it. Just remember, I've never done drugs. Isn't that insane? Can you imagine if I've done drugs? I have the mind of someone who had a long history with drugs without ever touching alcohol even. Never even had a cigarette. Just the voice of someone who's had a cigarette. All right, how many seconds left?
51.
51 left? All right, continue.
You're up on one. I was up on before. I was praying. I told my sons, I said, I really feel something's going to happen today.
Pause.
Sorry about that.
I told my sons, who were busy playing Twister with the Moldovan server, something's going to happen today. Who are, can I get, I just want to, I would like to see a picture of the sons. I feel, the more I watch this, that it's a son's problem. Not making any accusations, but I just would like to see a picture of the sons. Are they like trapeze artists, or what do they do? Continue. What are you?
But I'm so excited because I feel the Lord is going to do something. Mark, I feel like, you know, what Satan intends at times for evil, and always division, even over.
I don't want division.
Here's what I'm saying is, what sometimes Christian brothers can feel strongly about things that, and there's a difference.
Pause. See, this I don't get. And I don't like criticizing men of God, ever, no matter who they are. So this is not that. I will not do that. I don't understand, though, why, in a way, you're taking the side of the stripper. Brothers can have a difference about something? So he was against it and you're for it? I mean, why not say, like, listen, I had nothing to do with that guy coming on the ping pong table. I would have never approved. Let me tell you something. I can tell this crowd with a pure heart. If I had ever seen the words Moldovan male stripper on a piece of paper that came across my desk, I would have nixed it immediately. This was my, blame the youth pastor or something. Do what Barack Obama did to Lois Lerner, the head of the IRA. Just blame her and get her out. Why would you, back it up 20 seconds? Why are you taking up, I don't understand why you wouldn't come on the platform and say, like, I completely agree with what Pastor Mark said. I just didn't like the way it was handled. You're saying brothers can have a difference about things? So you're telling me you'd book that guy? Lars or whatever his name is? You'd have him back on next year? That's a little, that's suspect to me. All right, back it up 20 seconds. Go ahead.
I don't want division.
No, here's what I'm saying is, what sometimes Christian brothers can feel strongly about things that, and there's a difference. You know, there are some things there have to be differences over.
The things that matter, we agree.
I would like to hear the rest. Let me hear the last 5 seconds because Mark says something like, I think we can agree. I would have liked to have heard what they said next. Go ahead.
What sometimes Christian brothers can feel strongly about things that, and there's a difference. You know, there are some things there have to be differences over.
The things that matter, we agree.
Things that matter, we agree. Well, I saw this late at night before I went to sleep last night, and I hadn't really formulated an opinion on it. I was like, I could see things both ways. I could see how the pastor that put the event on would feel like his authority was undercut, and I could see how the guest speaker wouldn't want to go speak after a Moldovan male stripper was swallowing swords before the message. But now that I've watched it and had a chance to process it with you folks, I definitely see things Pastor Mark's way. I'm glad they were able to salvage their friendship, and people that paid $199 to go to that definitely got their money's worth. I'll tell you that. If they'd have known all that was going to happen, they could have charged like $1,000 a ticket for nosebleeds. No, you're right. My friend Solis from Louisiana said, I don't see video footage of this on either two preachers' X accounts. I looked at John Lindell's, Pastor John Lindell, and I would have thought there'd be something on there. You know, I guess the stripper skates. Can you imagine if you're him going back to the Moldovan male strip club? What's the capital of Moldova? So you're heading back to Chisumau. You're heading back to the Chisumau male strip club. And you're like, hey, guys, you're never going to believe the check I just collected. Guess who just paid me $5,000 to strip? A church. And then one of the pastors got mad, and they yelled at him. Can you believe it? Let's go have some Moldovan ethnic food that I wish I don't know what it is. What is Moldovan ethnic food? What's this guy eating besides swords, food-wise? What's Moldovan ethnic cuisine? How do you find out you know how to swallow swords? A suicide gone wrong? I'm going to kill myself. I did it. I didn't die. I have an ability. You know, the sooner Armageddon happens, the better. Israel, hey, Israel, if anybody's watching from IDF, Can we get this show on the road? What are you holding your missiles back for? Let's get this whole thing going. It's starting to get hard to not root for the destruction of the planet. All right, Moldovan ethnic cuisine. Very similar to Romanian. I also don't really know what that is. Greek, Polish, Ukrainian, and Russian. All right, I'm getting an idea. Stuffed cabbage rolls. Okay, like Polish. That's what my grandma would make. Accompanied by sauerkraut. And then a word I can't pronounce. All right, I got it. So you're going back to eat some stuffed cabbage rolls with the guys at the strip club. The fellow dancers. Hey, guys, guess who just made 7 large for 4 minutes of work? That's right, your buddy. Guess where? No, in America. Where were you, Vegas? Uh-uh. Springfield, Missouri. Stripping for the Assemblies of God. And get this. Didn't any of the pastors say anything to you? Oh, yeah. One guy got really mad, and they threw him out of the building. And old Lars, what's his name? I'm just assuming Lars, but it's probably something else. Let me see that. What's the one media piece we had from the British paper? Oh, it doesn't. Oh, yeah, Alex. Alex Magala. Find like a clean picture. I'm not trying to make the t-shirt dirty. How close are we on the t-shirt? All right. No, but about how much longer do you need? 20 minutes? 10 minutes. All right. Even if we have a rough copy of the shirt to put on as a graphic. All right. So before we wrap it up. So anyway, getting back to my thing I'm imagining happened. Okay, so you fly back to whatever the name of that city was. What was it again? Tiraspol or something? Chisinau. So you go back to Chisinau. They're like, hey, how's it going, Alex? Oh, man, you're never going to believe. I just made 7,000. Yeah, but our currency is so devalued. What are you going to buy with that? No, my friend, not 7,000 Moldovan dollars. 7,000 U.S. dollars. Holy moly, how'd you make that much money? Where did they have you? At a big club in Las Vegas, Atlantic City, San Francisco? Mm-mm. Keep guessing. Do you know where the Bass Pro Shop is? The original one in Springfield, Missouri? I was right by there, and an Assemblies of God church had me in to strip for the men. You're kidding me. Get out of here. No, I will not get out of here. I'm telling you the exact truth. I don't believe you. You're full of crap. All right, I'll show you. No. Didn't any of the pastors get mad? Oh, yeah. One guy got up and lit into me. So did they throw you out? Mm-mm. They threw him out. And old Alex Magala got his check and came straightly back to Chisinau. Now, what do you say we dive into some cabbage rolls, sliced carrots on me? Round of cabbage rolls and sliced carrots for everybody. I'm Alex Magala. And that, I believe, is how it ended. Now, if you're here and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, I would like to invite you to do that today, seeing as whether it's Iran or male strippers at Assemblies of God churches, we see signs that this world is drawing to a close. If you've never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're going through a hard time, I would love to pray with you right now. There will be no dancers before I pray. Just straight. Here, like, if you come see me in Las Vegas tonight, you know, you're not going to get entertained that much. We weren't able to book any Moldovan dancers. They were all booked other places. So you're just going to hear some run-of-the-mill praise and worship, and then I'll come up and preach out of the Bible, and then I'll pray for you. So I apologize, but you'll have a good time. And also, I would love for you to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. So if you've never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, pray this prayer with me right now, this large, growing, this inexplicably large viewing audience we have on social media. Say this out loud. Heavenly Father, is somebody praying the sinner's prayer in the media room? I thought I heard somebody repeat after me back there. was wondering how my staff fell away last night. We've only been in L.A. one night. Somebody dragged in, dirty, bleeding. Can I pray with you? All right. If you need to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, let's pray. Father, I admit that I've sinned. I repent. I believe in my heart you raised Jesus from the dead. I confess with my mouth Jesus is Lord and my Savior. Right now, I receive forgiveness. By the blood of Jesus, I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, welcome to the family of God. You can see it right on the comments. You click that link, revivaltoday.com, click I just got saved, making it easy for you. And I will for real send you a Bible and some other books to help you live the Christian life. And a sword signed by Alex Magala. What's that? We don't have the ability to get a sword signed by Alex Magala? Okay, just the Bible and the Christian books. And then I would love to have you at my church. We pastor two churches, one in Pittsburgh, one in Fort Worth, Texas. And there it is. Revival Today Church, Pittsburgh, 2419 State Avenue, Coraopolis, Pennsylvania, 15108. Revival Today Church, Fort Worth, 7200 Denton Highway, Watauga, Texas, at 9 in the morning. Would love to have you. If you go to a church that has seemed like it maybe has erred from its foundation and roots, and you're looking for a new church home, I can accommodate you in Texas and Pittsburgh. And then I would also really love to see you tonight in Los Angeles. Do we have the Diddy video? Okay, I'm going to be in Los Angeles. That's me when I was much angrier. And I'm going to be, we started last night, April 14th to the 19th. You can leave the graphic up. April 14th to the 19th. Sheraton Gateway, that's where I'm at right now, 6101 West Century Boulevard, Los Angeles, California, 90045, 7 o'clock every night. No day services. I'll be here with you online so we can spend some time together today, every afternoon. Here is the promo for these meetings that I would love to have yet. Hello, this is Evangelist Jonathan Shuttlesworth, and if you're on the West Coast, I want to invite you to something that I believe will change your life. April 14th through the 19th, Revival Los Angeles. Sheraton Gateway, Los Angeles, 6101 West Century Boulevard in the great city of Los Angeles, California. Sunday through Friday, every night at 7 p.m. Pacific time. Go to revivaltoday.com and register on our events page. It's free to attend, but you have to register. I'm going to be there, and I'm believing God not only to do great things in your life, but to do something that week that turns the tide in the entire West Coast of America. God's not finished with America. God's not finished with California, and God's not finished with you. April 14th through the 19th, I will see you at the Sheraton Gateway Hotel in Los Angeles, California for Revival Los Angeles. I'm actually starting to dress like how I am in the AI videos. What happened? Now, I'm going to make you a guarantee. If you'll come to the meeting tonight, I can't guarantee there'll be any blind people healed. I can't guarantee there'll be any deaf people healed. I can't guarantee you somebody will come out of a wheelchair. But I will guarantee you, no one will maintain eye contact with you while taking their shirt off. That, I give you my solemn promise. You, my friend, can take that to the bank. We are almost have the T-shirt. I want to give you an opportunity to give and stand with us here in Los Angeles. And I would love if you made a strong showing in your giving today. Now, I'm going to send you a T-shirt that we're going to show you very shortly. That was the men's conference, Stronger Men's Conference. It's going to have Pastor John Lindell's face, Pastor Mark Driscoll's face, Alex Malaga's face, and then it's going to say, I went to the Stronger Men's Conference, and all I saw was, what was it again? A male Moldovan stripper. To just commemorate this event. It's almost ready. So I'm gonna stay online with you so you get to see it. I'm going to send that T-shirt. Where will you wear it? You know, to me, the funny thing is knowing about 2 months from now, I'm going to be in a meeting at a church, and there's going to be like a 58-year-old church lady with an... I went to the Stronger Men's Conference, and all I saw was a male Moldovan stripper with the three faces. And I've completely forgot we did any of this. And then I'm going to see that. Like, what's this lady? Oh, our ministry mailed that to people. So we have, that's good. Somebody came in the comments. Over 500 people got saved or recommitted at that men's event. That's great. So a lot of good games. No, it's good. Good. I'm glad. You know, different bait for different fish. Again, I said from the beginning, I don't know how I could say it any more times, I'm not criticizing anybody or anything. I'm just pointing out something that happened. And thought on Monday we'd break down a little film. Instead of breaking down NFL film, we'd break down some Moldovan male stripper footage in Assemblies of God Church. Not something you get to see every day. ETA on the t-shirt. Johnny, you don't even want to know. Just go about your day. Is anybody watching this at work? Emoji hand if you're watching this at work. Leanne's watching it at work. Uh-oh. Gina's watching it at work. Nate's watching it at work. Lewis in Massachusetts is watching it at work. Austin, I'm watching this at work and really fighting to not laugh. Where do you work, Austin? I'm stunned anyone hired you. Nathan Barker at work. Johnny Word at work. Mackenzie McHugh watching it at North Point Bible College, working for my dad. I'm sure he's thrilled. A lot of people are watching it at work. No wonder the American economy is slipping into oblivion. I used to blame Biden. Now I blame you people. What? Okay, we have a sample, and then we're going to make adjustments to make it better. But for everybody that gives today, we're doing a crusade in Los Angeles. I'm in the ministry. If you say, seriously? I know. That's the reaction I normally get. I would love to see you tonight, 7 o'clock. If you'll help us. Now, Cash App just delisted us and won't allow people to give to our ministry anymore. Anytime that that's happened to us, you people have rallied behind the strong with your giving. So I have my faith out for $1 million a week. If you enjoyed the program today and got you a little laugh and you want to, out of your joy, sow into the work of the Lord, I'm going to give you this t-shirt to commemorate one of the greatest afternoons we've ever had together. Let's take a look. Oh, no. Okay. I mean, I'm trying to think of a way to class it up a little bit. But it's going to be challenging. Oh, no. Yeah. The middle picture. Let's do just his face. I don't want to be looking at that while I'm preaching because people wear these to the meetings. And then. No, that's good. Just if change his body up for his face. And that's good. We will. This part's not a joke. We're going to send this shirt to you as a way of saying thank you for standing with us in the ministry. And anybody that gives a, I'll say this too. Then I'll also give my new book. Great job on the shirt, Anthony. The Art of Spiritual Warfare. This drops May 7th, and I'm going to put you on the pre-order list. Oh, that's true. No. Put, let me see the shirt again. Somebody said, why is Bill Johnson on the shirt? That is Bill Johnson. Good catch. But they have the same haircut and the same dress. Good catch. Who caught that? Yes, Judah Lee. Great, great catch. Pastor Lou in Oregon. Good to see you. Pastor Lou said, standing with you, Pastor Lou Wooten, but I won't pole dance for you. If Pastor Lou Wooten wanted to pole dance, the pole would have to be made out of Captain America's shield. Vibranium. I love you, Pastor Lou. Looking forward to seeing you again. You're a great, I wish I was here. Wish you were here so we could laugh together. Well, I'm glad we got to the bottom of that. So put the shirt back up again. We will get the right pastor up. We will get that gross middle picture replaced with just his face. You know, and then we'll have a space between the A and the M. It's not a Moldovan male stripper. It's a Moldovan stripper, male stripper. And you know what? Let's get a Moldovan flag at the bottom just to pay homage to a country that often gets overlooked. So if you give by Cash App, you got to switch to another kind of giving. Let's have a big giving day. What do you say, folks? I gave you my all today. I'm away from my family. I'm giving you what I normally give to my family, which a lot of times my family doesn't really want this, so they're probably glad I'm gone because I'm always trying to make adults laugh. And sometimes you're like, can you just go in like another room for a little bit? I'm not paying to be at one of your performances. Enough with it. Stop working out new material on me. All right. Why did Cash App remove me? Who knows? Why has anyone tolerated me? Would probably be the better question. Here's the ways to give. You, Leanne said, we are your family. Take it easy, Leanne. RevivalToday.com. You click give now. Zelle, I don't know what that is, but that's what we're going to replace Cash App with. Pending our appeal. Info@RevivalToday.com on Zelle. Venmo @RTGive. RevivalToday.com/PayPal. #donate if you're watching on Facebook. Text RT to 501. Listen, whether you enjoyed today or not, I needed this. This was like a vacation wrapped in a broadcast. I really, Luffridge 72 said, are you a prosperity preacher? Not at all. I can't stand prosperity. I feel like preachers shouldn't have nice things. Some of the things that I see a preacher owns irritates me, to be honest with you, when that money could be sold and given to the poor. Anyway, giving graphic. Next one. If you want to mail a large check and make old Johnny smile, Revival Today, P.O. Box 7, Prosperity, Pennsylvania, 15329. Don't forget to claim your offer at RevivalToday.com. Claim my offer. That makes sure we have your name and address to send you the beautiful T-shirt and the book. It's going to be so funny seeing people wear this. Looking forward to a cease and desist letter from the Stronger Men's Conference. Think of you having to explain that to people. Sister Joanne, what are you wearing? Let me just tell you a 9-minute story that would explain this t-shirt. It's an inside joke shared by like 11 people. You guys are wearing this at the grocery store? I am coming to Chicago before long. Thank you for your giving. Lou, Pastor Lou, I'll get you a shirt that'll fix you. That'll fit you. You're a big guy. You're not like call the fire department to remove a wall, can't get a shirt for you guy. We went shopping down at Filson. You fit in the stuff in the store. Just a big, strong guy. Now, Tom McCarrick said, that's funny, question mark. Now, I'll be honest. If you jumped in at the end of this broadcast, I don't blame you for being horrified. If you came on at the beginning of the broadcast, I don't blame you for being horrified. There. Boy, him and Bill Johnson. Same shade of spray tan. I have the Norvell Clear Dark. Right? Another guy named Tom. It's starting to look like people named Tom don't have a sense of humor. Why are we letting giving this much airtime? I don't know. I don't really have anything prepared, to be honest with you. I don't really have anything else to go to. I don't have friends. My family is on the other side of the country. So I'm sorry. Apologize to you and anyone else I've offended. My deepest apologies. I've had to apologize to so many people in my life. I can do it in my sleep. I could give you the most like deep apology. I like to apologize for my actions. I've embarrassed myself and my family. And I pray that you could find it in your heart to forgive my mistakes today. How's that? I was going to get kicked out of Bible college, and it was contingent upon me giving an apology that was sincere. No problem. That's like asking Superman to fly. Lit off firecrackers in a kid's room at 2 in the morning. A ton of them. And it scared him so bad, he soiled his pants. Blew up the room. In a little Bible college dorm room. So the dean didn't think it was funny. I thought it was funny. I thought anyone who heard about it would think it was funny. So 8 of us get called in. Gentlemen, those firecrackers left burn marks on the carpet, which means a fire could have started, which means you could have burned down the entire dormitory. You put 100 people's lives on the line for your joke. I thought, you know, that's a different way of looking at it than the way I was looking at it. I was never looked at it from the perspective of mass murder. So they went to kick us out. And then the president knew my dad, and he knew one of the other kids' dads. So they said, they're not going to kick us out, but we have to apologize to the whole student body. And if the apology's sincere, they won't kick us out. So Superman went to work. From the depth of my heart, I want to apologize to everyone today for the brutality of my actions. I'll tell you that Pol Pot, Benito Mussolini, and Joseph Stalin pale in comparison to the evil that was expressed from my heart today. To all the staff, faculty, and students at this school, if you never look at me again, I don't blame you. What a grievous assault on your dignity I performed. My actions have embarrassed both myself and the church at large. Thank you for finding it in your heart to forgive me. All right. Tonight through Friday, 7 p.m. We're going to have a good time. If you're anywhere near Los Angeles, Arizona, Gina, thank you. 7 o'clock, Sheraton Gateway, Los Angeles, 6101 West Century Boulevard. I'll see you tonight. Help me get the word out if you would. No, it did fly, Rose. I didn't get kicked out. I didn't laugh or anything. Dead-faced, good apology. Somewhere, a Moldovan male stripper counts as Assemblies of God church money. Good night, everybody. Going back to Cali, Cali. Hello, this is Evangelist Jonathan Shuttlesworth, and if you're on the West Coast, I want to invite you to something that I believe will change your life. April 14th through the 19th, Revival Los Angeles. Sheraton Gateway, Los Angeles, 6101 West Century Boulevard in the great city of Los Angeles, California. Sunday through Friday, every night at 7 p.m. Pacific time. Go to revivaltoday.com and register on our events page. It's free to attend, but you have to register. I'm going to be there, and I'm believing God not only to do great things in your life, but to do something that week that turns the tide in the entire West Coast of America. God's not finished with America, God's not finished with California, and God's not finished with you. April 14th through the 19th, I will see you at the Sheraton Gateway Hotel in Los Angeles, California for Revival Los Angeles.